fever. First question that you have to ask is it truly fever? Because many times our patient will say, tapa sarka vatai. Bukhar jaisa lagta hai. Meetha meetha bukhar hai. I know of certain primary care practitioners who do not even have a thermometer in the clinic. We have to insist on temperature readings. The first question is, if you are saying you have fever for 3 days, how often did you check? And the 90% time patient will say, I did not check because I was warm. Now people, when they have fever, cover themselves with blanket. A blanket's job is to retain heat inside. They are bound to feel hot. People touch forehead with the palm. We know that 25% of our blood supply goes to the head and brain, and we know that the blood is warm. So forehead is always going to appear warmer than rest of the body. If mother feels, and then she calls 4 other members of the family to touch the forehead, everybody is transmitting their body heat to the patient. And then nobody wants to take a risk by saying fever nahi hai. So then the mother will come and tell you, ghar mein sabne dekha, sabko body garam laga. And the second thing is, sir garam hai, paon thanda hai. I think we have to learn that we do not have to go by subjective complaints. Fever, fortunately, there is a method of measuring. Weakness you cannot measure. But fever, blood pressure, blood sugar, you can measure. So I have to ask, is it fever or is it feverish fever? The commonest cause of people feeling malaise, this feverish feeling is actually malaise. And the commonest cause I have seen in my practice is semi-dehydration. I'll take a minute to explain to you. I have 5 liters of blood in my body and I consume 2 liters of water. I should consume 2 liters of water in a day. When my body has true fever, the fever or the temperature of the body evaporates water. My need increases to 2.5 to 3 liters. But I have a unique complaint of toned kadu. I don't feel like drinking. I think 1.5 liters. If my requirement was 2.5, I'm taking 1.5. There's almost 40% deficit. And the malaise feeling begins. So first thing you have to always ask the patient, water intake. And if the fever is not been monitored or in your clinic thermometer does not show fever, other vitals are normal, I think this patient can be told to hydrate well, eat nutritious food, keep a 24-hour chart. If there are no localizing signs, nothing is going to happen to this patient. Is it measured or by just touch on forehead or cheek? If measured, how often? Most of the knowledgeable patients only check when they feel feverish. We have to insist on a 2-hourly reading. I have a chart in my clinic which we give to every fever patient. I'm sorry I cannot show that today because I'm working from home. But in the WhatsApp broadcast group, I will share it with you. You all can Xerox, put your rubber stamp and distribute it. And below the fever chart, we have given minimal diet requirement for patient with fever. Then second problem that occurs for us is patient waste time. Sir, 11:30 exo tha, fir 3:30 itna tha. I refuse to hear all that. I say, put it down on paper and send that snapshot to me. This is how I want the patient to chart temperature. And this becomes easy for me. This lady is smart. She's even given 2 liters water, what was dinner, what was breakfast, everything. Many people, I tell them, you with an arrow, you indicate what time you took the tablet. So then we know everything. I think my internet became unstable. I am sure everybody can hear now. Then secondly, as a doctor, we have to realize and we have to convey this to our patient, apraxia is not the goal. I do not want the temperature at 98.4 or below that. I want optimum paresis, because that small fever of till 99, 99.5, that actually kills pyrogens, some bacteria. So please discourage patients on taking Dolo 650 or Crocin or Nice just because the body feels warm. We need, and for us clinical diagnosis, we need a chart. Supportive therapy, as I already explained, hydration is most important. Soft, easily digestible, nutritious diet. Fruits, vegetables, salads, soups. All these things can be digested. Khichdi, aloo paratha, these things can be easily digested, and insist that patient should eat, if not more, at least what they take on a normal day. Replenishing losses. If the patient is vomiting or diarrhea, then we have to replenish by giving electrolyte solution. If the patient has nausea of fever, then we have to give them curd, and then we have to convince them that by taking curd or milk, the fever does not rise or the infection does not get worse. Before I hand over to Alka ma'am to talk on fevers, some universal precautions as and when the lockdown unlocks fully and we go to the clinic. There should be a signage. You should have enough signs outside your clinic telling people that what are your rules for the clinic. In my clinic now, because of my waiting room size, only one patient is allowed to wait in the clinic, one inside, no relatives allowed inside. If the child or the patient is 7 or 8 years and above, parents can stand out, talk to the doctor on phone, the child comes inside. I am reducing the possibility of cross-infection. Nobody is taken by an appointment. A very nice line I read somewhere, there is no emergency in pandemic. As a doctor, I have to keep myself safe first before I make sure that my patient is safe. I will also forward on the Dropbox and the WhatsApp a small message a pharma company had given to me, which we forward to everyone when appointment is taken, so that they know that when they come, they have to wear a mask, they have to sanitize themselves and everything. Avoid fever patients in clinic. Try to give them treatment on phone basis. I can keep 2 to 3 pulse oximeters. One relative can come, pick up from the clinic, go home, check. We take it back, sanitize it. I'm getting all the information. I can talk to the patient on phone, video call. But I would try to avoid a fever patient coming to my clinic. Or if it is mandatory, suppose my clinic times are 9 to 1, I keep 12 to 1 for fever patients, because then I will disinfect my clinic. It's like, you know, a perianal abscess in a surgery theater is taken last. All other surgeries are done before. Last is perianal abscess. So similarly, I'll give a fixed slot towards the end of the practice. Social distancing. You cannot allow people to sit next to each other in a waiting room. There should be distancing. Washable mask and face shield to all the staff who are present in the clinic. Some people have started using surgical gowns. You can use that. Using gloves is not recommended unless you are going to change glove for every patient. But if my dispensing chemist or my receptionist uses a glove, If they touch some infected surface, they are going to transfer that to another surface they touch. PPE, you should be wearing a PPE, a disposable PPE, and any clinical assistant. If you have a clinical assistant who takes BP, temperature, gives injections, then that clinical assistant should be in a PPE and with N95 mask and face shield. Change of glove for every patient. So if you are examining patients, if you are touching, then you change the glove for every patient. I have a pathology franchise in my clinic. So the phlebotomist will change the glove after every blood collection. Sanitizer, there are devices available now costing 800 to 1200 rupees, which are operated by foot. They should be kept outside the clinic or just at the entrance so that anybody who comes in sanitizes the hand. They may say, "Hum ghar se karke aaye hain," but no, you must sanitize here also. And nobody is allowed in with a mask, without a mask. If you have a good practice and you are charging people for everything, you can keep a box of masks and say, "You can pick up this mask, this will be charged." And do not hesitate in increasing your charges if you are spending so much money in the clinic. And lastly, as you are going out, the entire clinic, all surfaces should be disinfected by using a fogger and a sodium thiosulfate solution. Now, I request Alka ma'am to start her talk.
Good afternoon, everybody. And I am thankful to Dr. Asrani for inviting me for this webinar. Everybody is worried about this COVID and Corona, and therefore people are so scared about it. They feel that fever means it is COVID. But there are many illnesses which are very common anytime in Mumbai. Particularly now, this is monsoon. And therefore, when there are frequent weather changes, naturally people will come down with fever. And today we are going to discuss this febrile illness, how we should handle in COVID era. Now, acute febrile illness, it is acute. And we are not talking about chronic febrile illness like low-grade fever in pulmonary TB. So this is acute. It could be because of acute URI. It could be acute lower respiratory tract infection. It could be acute dengue, acute swine flu. Although WHO has already declared that the epidemic of swine flu is over, but still we are getting cases in Pune and surrounding area. Acute chikungunya round the ear, and it can come anytime. Malaria is our good old friend. And today only I read it in the papers that both dengue and malaria are on rise in Mumbai. Acute leptospirosis, all the flooding around us, and that is predisposes to leptospirosis. Typhoid, our good old friend again, enteric fever. Acute urinary tract infection, because of this weather, because of, you know, damp clothes and other thing, the genital hygiene is not proper. And there are many other factors, and therefore urinary tract infections are also very common, which present with fever. And GI infections, it could be simple diarrhea, infective diarrhea, or other GI infections, but they don't present with fever. If at all, I have to say hepatitis A and hepatitis E. They get mild fever, but more than that, the other symptoms like anorexia, nausea are more prominent. Now, respiratory infections, these are acute infections. Patient will present with fever. And as Dr. Asrani has already elaborated, they talk about fever, but their terminology is so varied that we have to confirm that they really get fever. There is fever, there is malaise. I also keep all the patients to keep a temperature chart and show me. Otherwise, I don't believe. Because muh kadwa hai, khana achha nahi lagta, that is also fever. So this fever is something like chakkar. Chakkar aata hai. And you ask them what exactly they mean by chakkar, and they can't explain. So there is fever, malaise, there is body ache. These are all viral infection. When we talk about upper respiratory tract infection. These are viral infections. It is a flu virus. And therefore, we get fever, malaise, body ache, coryza, running nose, sore throat, change in voice because of the sore throat, anosmia. If there is a lot of nasal congestion and severe cold, they do not get the smell. And today in COVID era, people get alarmed when they lose smell sense. So this anosmia is very common even with common cold because your nose is congested and therefore anosmia is there. So therefore we examine the upper respiratory tract. What I would request you that when you are examining upper respiratory tract, now in the family practice, it is not possible to examine the nose with the nares, but we can examine the oral cavity, we can examine the ears, and we should note down each and everything. In the oral cavity, we see the tonsils. If there are any spots on the tonsils, we see the posterior pharyngeal wall. We see the teeth, whether there are any caries, dental, you know, the gum hygiene and or gum condition of the gums, and all these could be the source of fever. Similarly, when there is a severe pharyngitis, patient complains of ear blocks. Because the eustachian tube is blocked, they can't hear. But even otherwise, we should examine the ear. And last and but not the least is the sinuses, paranasal sinuses. If the patient is having sinusitis, acute sinusitis, there will be tenderness over the maxillary and frontal sinuses. So please do not forget to check it. Because from these infected sinuses, there is a continuous discharge which is coming to the nose and symptoms are getting aggravated. When the patient, because of the severe pharyngitis, can complain of cough. When the infection, the viral infection goes down to the lower respiratory tract, we call it as tracheobronchitis. And before tracheobronchitis, it is laryngitis. So the patient develops hoarseness of the voice. Then there is a very irritating type of a cough. It may be a dry cough, or after that, when he gets a secondarily infected, there could be a mucopurulent expectoration. So now we know that the infection has gone to the lower respiratory tract. Now, when it is lower respiratory tract, why I'm saying, you know, the approach will be slightly different, because here also when the patient comes with acute URI, you are all treating them for body ache, malaise and all that, simple paracetamol, steam inhalations, gargles. This is the common treatment. If at all you can give some antihistaminics, but with antihistaminics, the secretions become very dry. Patient gets a very irritating dry cough. Pneumonia is a separate entity. It is a lower respiratory tract infection. Patient gets wet or drenched in this monsoon, comes with high fever with chills. Classically, the patient gets cough with expectoration, and that expectoration is supposed to be rusty sputum. But in this case, patient looks very toxic, maybe hypotension, and please get the X-ray chest done, because that is the only answer to show us the pneumonia. The moment there is pneumonia, please do not think of COVID. I'll come to that COVID later on. But pneumonia is caused by streptococcal pneumonia, which is the commonest cause of pneumonia in our community. Then we come to another viral infection, and that is dengue. Now, all these are viral infections. Remember, there are four types of dengue. This is N1 to 4. It is transmitted by Aedes aegypti mosquito. These mosquitoes breed in the fresh water. And therefore, you can see the way we collect the water in all around societies and houses in Mumbai. Forget these places, but even the potted plants in our house, the water that collects at the bottom, that can be a breeding site for this Aedes aegypti, and that causes the transmission of dengue. What are the signs and symptoms of dengue? There is classically, if you open the book, they write about bone breaking pain. This is something very, very peculiar that the patient gets, as if all the bones are breaking. It may last for a few minutes to an hour, but this usually happens 4 days to 1 week prior to the fever. And therefore, he never connects this bone breaking pain to the fever. So after 4 to 7 days, the patient gets fever. By that time, he has forgotten about this bone breaking pain. But if you ask him, then he says, yes, yes, I had a very peculiar thing which I never had in my life. Patient gets high fever. Usually it is starts with 101 and can go up to 104. Severe headache. There is a pain behind the eyes and pain in the muscles. Joint pains, nausea, vomiting. See, these are all common presentations of viral infection, and therefore we also call them like flu-like syndrome. Swollen glands, and what is most important, that you can see a dengue rash. Okay, now even then it is very difficult to say that it is dengue till you do your investigations. The symptoms usually last for 2 to 7 days. What is the pathogenesis? There is, once this dengue virus is infected, there is an aberrant immune response. All these viruses, unfortunately, are RNA viruses, and they replicate inside the cell. And they have an aberrant, the immune dysfunction of the host body. So there is an aberrant immune response. There are autoantibodies which are produced against the host platelets and vascular endothelium. There is interferon gamma, which is interferon gamma activated macrophages, and these macrophages destroy these platelets, which are coated with autoantibodies. Therefore, there is a thrombocytopenia. Now, there is a damage to vascular endothelium also, because the vascular endothelium is damaged. The plasma is extravasating. The fluid is going out, and there is a capillary leak. And what happens? Because of the capillary leak, the hematocrit goes on increasing. That is the importance that we have to monitor the hematocrit every day. Then there is an overproduction of cytokines, and these cytokines finally lead to cytokine storm. Now, I'm using this term because of the COVID era, everybody has become very familiar with cytokine storm and ARDS and whatnot. But all these things had been occurring with all these viral infections. Okay. In fact, it's way back in 93, 94, when there was a malaria which had suddenly come, recrudescence of malaria in our country. That time I had published my paper on ARDS and tropical infections. We were really surprised to see ARDS developing in malaria, ARDS developing in this dengue, and treatment of malaria and ARDS will resolve. So similarly, with viral infections, there is an overproduction of cytokines and there is a cytokine storm. Now, what is the cytokine storm? This leads to antibody-dependent enhancement in a vulnerable host, and therefore this causes dengue hemorrhagic fever or dengue shock syndrome. Now, this usually happens if the patient had first episode of dengue, he has recovered, and he gets infection second time. So there is a second virus which infects him, and then only he goes into this DHF and DSS. So if a patient comes with history of fever, please also inquire whether he had dengue any time in the past. How do we diagnose in your clinic? Because there is nothing else is positive. Maybe patient is febrile, there is a rash. Do a tourniquet test. Tie the tourniquet, raise the pressure in the cuff. You take a mean pressure of systolic and diastolic put together, divided by 2. So raise the pressure up to that, and within few minutes there will be more than 10 petechial spots per square inch. So if you see these bleeding spots, you are sure that this is dengue. Ask for a CBC, that will show low platelet count. The platelets will be less than 1,20,000. The PCV will be raised. PCV is hematocrit, and that indicates that there is a capillary leak. This is to be monitored daily, because we have to correct the hematocrit, which is rising. Otherwise, capillary leak will continue. Laboratory diagnosis, you all know that it is NS1 antigen, which is positive up to 3 days of the fever. This is non-structural protein of the virus, which is detected. So it is an antigen. With this antigen, naturally the immune response is triggered in the body, and therefore after 3 days, dengue IgM seroconversion takes place, and the IgM comes positive within first week. So that confirms that NS1 antigen test was our correct test, and now the patient has responded and IgM has come positive. Fashionably, you can do RT-PCR, but we don't do it because it is very expensive. What is the management? Daily monitor the hematocrit, platelet. and there is something called as immature platelet fraction. If we can measure the immature platelet fraction, and if the immature platelet fraction is high, that indicates now the body has started responding by producing platelets, and therefore the prognosis is going to be good. The patient is coming out very soon. So therefore, but it is a little expensive, so at least monitor hematocrit and platelet. Give adequate fluids to maintain the hematocrit within normal range. So he can, if the hematocrit is slightly increased, he can take oral fluids, take all sorts of fluids, liquids. Avoid aspirin and NSAIDs, because there is a thrombocytopenia. This may precipitate bleeding. Platelet transfusion is indicated only if platelet count is less than 20,000 or there is an active bleeding. This being a viral fever, antibiotics are not required. What are the complications of dengue that we have seen? Again, this is a virus which affects all the systems in the body. We have seen acute demyelinating encephalomyelitis, heart, myocarditis, pericarditis, arrhythmia. Now, all these terms I'm using because you are hearing them fresh with COVID, because COVID is also a viral infection. So virus, this disseminates and affects all the organs in the body. Then ARDS, dengue causing ARDS, and what is with the second infection, the patient gets hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis syndrome, HLH syndrome. And this secondary HLH syndrome is very common even in the COVID patient. So these are what I'm telling you, these are the common problems with any viral infections. Chikungunya. Now you have seen large number of cases of chikungunya. They go around the ear. The patient comes with high grade fever. There is pharyngitis. There is conjunctival suffusion, conjunctivitis or photophobia. There is a lymphadenopathy. It may be only in the neck or it may be generalized. There is severe arthralgia, and that is the hallmark of chikungunya viral infection. And rash. So in dengue we had rash, in chikungunya also we are having rash. So this is a hallmark of viral fevers. Now as you know, in the pediatric age group, we get exanthematous fever. So these fevers are diagnosed only on 3rd, 4th, and 5th day, and there is an exanthema. What is exanthema? There is a rash, like measles, like chickenpox. So this is an exanthematous fever. We are talking mainly about the adults. So in chikungunya, severe arthralgia and rash. What investigations we should do? Because this is viral fever, there is a lymphocytopenia. When you do CBC, the lymphocyte count is very, very low. There is increased CRP, C-reactive protein. This is a sign of inflammation in the body. So there is a C-reactive protein. As such, there is arthralgia, which then goes on to arthropathy. So there is an inflammation. So C-reactive proteins are increased. And there is elevated levels of cytokines that indicate the disease activity. So these elevated levels of cytokines, like other conditions, dengue also, we had raised cytokines. And this is what is going to complicate the chikungunya. The diagnosis may be by RT-PCR, but the simplest diagnosis will be by IgM antibody within 2 weeks. Because all the bodies, you know, the host responds to any infection by producing antibodies. So IgM antibody within 2 weeks will be positive. Rising titer of IgG, because after IgM, then there is the immunoglobulin G which is produced, and this antibody is going to increase gradually, and therefore we will get rising titer, but that will only indicate that the past infection was chikungunya. So this is not for diagnosing an acute infection, but this gives indication that patient had chikungunya. Then H1N1 swine flu. As I said, WHO has declared that if the endemic pandemic is over, but sporadic cases are do occurring. It is a tree assortment virus coming from swine, avian and human. You know, avian flu and the swine flu. So this particular virus is a reassortment of three viruses. Patient comes with acute fever, malaise, body ache, myalgia, fatigue. As I said, flu-like syndrome. So all this is common. Cough, dry, sometimes it is productive. Vomiting and diarrhea. Now see, all these signs you are also hearing about the corona infection and pneumonia. Now Finally, this pneumonia is complicated by bacterial infection and lands up in sepsis and followed by multi-organ failure. And these are the critical cases which have to be treated in a separate ICU. What are the investigation? H1N1 RT-PCR, real-time PCR. Now, this is the for which we have to take a throat swab, and throat swab has to be properly taken and properly transported. Then CBC, arterial blood gases as he develops pneumonia, X-ray and HRCT to find out the extent of pneumonia, and then the patient may need a ventilatory support based on the ABG and HRCT. The treatment is oseltamivir, 75 milligram twice a day for 5 days. Zanamivir can be added, and that is given as a rotahaler, 10 milligram twice a day, and supportive treatment, as I said, oxygen, ventilator, all that is as needed. And of course, the hydration of the patient is very important. Now, H1N1 is under control, but the viruses, all these viruses are mutating very fast. And therefore, now there are many variants of this H1N1. There is H5N9, there is H7N5, all sorts of combinations are coming. And these viruses are at the moment, as small outbreaks are having in certain parts of the world. What are the commonalities in this viral infection? All these viruses are single-strand RNA viruses, including corona. So these are RNA viruses, and these RNA viruses, you know, with a reverse transcriptase, they get converted into DNA, and then they multiply inside the human body in the cell. So they're destroying the cell, they're using the human body. And one thing, remember, the basic thing, that all the viruses are obligate parasite, and therefore they will survive only in the human beings or, you know, their host. Without host outside, they will not survive for a long time. So these are single stranded RNA. And it is long time back, you must be watching on the WhatsApp, that Bill Gates had said that large number of epidemics are coming and we are not prepared, in the infrastructure wise. And he also hinted that we don't have vaccines against these RNA viruses. It is so very true. And in fact, you must have also read in the papers or WhatsApp pe news aaya hoga, that America was funding billions of dollars to Wuhan laboratory to develop this vaccine against RNA viruses. HIV is a RNA virus, which started way back in 1981. Then all these RNA viruses are going to bother us for this decade to come. So these are single stranded RNA viruses. All of them cause immune dysfunction. There are two types. They have a mild self-limiting disease. And today, as we see, that 80% patients recovery. And we are very happy that 80% patients in Mumbai are recovering. In Thane, there are 81%. But majority of these people have a very mild disease. It is self-limiting. Okay? But when there is an immune dysfunction, it takes a severe form. And that severe form will present with ARDS, cytokine storm, hemophagocytosis, and disseminated intravascular coagulation. So these are the commonalities in all the viral infections, and that is what we have to worry, and we have to be prepared to manage these patients. Then I come to a bacterial infection, that is leptospirosis. Leptospirosis is caused by spirochete, that is spirochete interrogen. Now, as you can see, this is a spirochete, a spiral structure of this organism. It comes in two forms. It comes as a mild leptospirosis, or it can come with septicemic phase. The septicemic phase will be acute, or there will be a delayed immune phase. The target organs in this septicemic phase are lungs and the kidney. Remember that. How it is transmitted? You know, the reservoir, the host reservoir are the rodents and the rats. And their urine, when they pass, that contaminates the water, the soil, or the food. And as you can see in the monsoon, we have flooding everywhere. We have waterlogging everywhere. The children are playing in that. They are enjoying this waterlogging. They are even swimming in that. And with they are exposing their open wounds to this particular organism. And that is how it is the entry of this spirochete inside the human body. What are the risk factors? It could be occupational. The farmers who are working with bare feet in their farms where there is a water logging, the sewage workers, they are of course naturally working in those drains and which are naturally contaminated with the urine of the rodents, the slaughterhouse workers, veterinary surgeons, they are also vulnerable for this infection. Recreational factors like swimming, windsurfing. Now, unless we are very careful about this swimming and you know the water in the swimming pool, all that can be contaminated and can pass on this infection. Household exposure. Household exposure is also possible. There is a direct contact or exposure to soil containing with contaminated with urine from domesticated livestock, pet dogs, because these are all these animals which are the reservoirs. And therefore, if you have pet dogs or if you come in contact with the urine of this the pet animals, that can also cause the infection. Therefore, one must have a high index of suspicion. Therefore, history is very, very important. The patient will come with fever, malaise, body ache, and all those things. But there has to be a high index of suspicion. Where do you stay? Was there water logging? Were you caught in this Bombay floods and all that? Patient comes with fever, headache, muscle pain. There is meningism. Remember that. Conjunctival suffusion. Most of these patients have suffusion or subconjunctival hemorrhage. So have a good look at the eyes, along with subconjunctival suffusion or subconjunctival the hemorrhage, the patient, you know, this is little severe form, has affected the liver, and you can see also the jaundice in the eyes. So there will be icterus. The patient, if the lungs are involved, naturally will come with hemoptysis. There will be a hepatomegaly. Patient can complain of diarrhea, hypotension, because all these finally cause a shock-like condition, and therefore the BP is low. Reduced urine output. Naturally, because there is hypotension, the urine output is reduced. What investigation we will do? This is a spirochetal and a bacterial infection. Therefore, there is leukocytosis. Now, this is another condition with thrombocytopenia. Therefore, there is suffusion. And what investigation we have to do is leptospiral IgM antibody. Urine analysis is done for proteinuria, hematuria, and HGOT-HGPT are elevated if the liver is affected. So these are the investigations what we do in leptospira. But leptospira, by clinical examination, we are fairly correct in 90% of the cases. It is confirmed by leptospiral IgM antibody. And then our good old friend, that is malaria. Malaria, around the year going on everywhere. We are in a endemic country now. Plasmodium has more than 100 species, but they infect animals. Human beings are infected by Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium falciparum, ovale, and malaria. Vector is female Anopheles mosquito. Okay. Now the clinical profile is moderate to severe shaking chills. Actually, it should not be called a chills, it is rigors. Okay, so severe rigors, he has to take 3 or 4 blankets. Many a times the people, the family members are holding him down because he is, you know, he's severely shaking. So they hold him down with the blanket. So he gets severe rigors followed by high fever. And the fever comes down with profuse sweating. Now, this is a very classical picture of malaria. He gets headache, muscle pain, nausea and vomiting, and patient has a splenomegaly. So this picture is slightly altered. I mean, the patient, if there is a falciparum malaria, going to the cerebral malaria, patient can come with altered sensorium. And this can happen within first 24 to 48 hours also. Acute kidney injury. And ARDS, malaria causing ARDS. Therefore, prompt diagnosis and the treatment is very, very important. Now, what has happened in our country? Because we all have been exposed and we have a subclinical immunity, and therefore this classical picture is getting modified. So every patient need not come with very high fever and you know, severe shaking rigors. They can feel that, yes, I was feeling a little chilly, then I had some fever. But what is most important is the periodicity of the symptoms. I have seen patients coming at 7 o'clock in our casualty complaining of abdominal pain. It happens only at 7 o'clock. It lasts for about half an hour to 1 hour and then it disappears. Maybe it's mild fever, but otherwise it is periodicity. Some people were coming with, you know, severe body ache only at that time. Hypoglycemia, again because of the malaria, and that was again at a particular time of the day. So this periodicity is very important when we ask the history. And then because of the endemicity, all this is getting modified. Diagnosis of malaria, there are very fashionable tests now which are called as rapid diagnostic tests. These are dipsticks and whatnot. But I think the best method is peripheral smear, thick and thin smear, which is inexpensive and time tested. Malarial antigen also has come in the vogue, and in countries where they are doing a lot of research, they also do PCR. So malarial antigen, but I think peripheral smear in a good laboratory hand will help it. Now, when we are treating malaria today, all of you know that there is a chloroquine-resistant malaria, which is particularly falciparum, but even Vivax has become resistant. Now, in a falciparum, if the patient is having cerebral complaints, we can use quinine safely. Remember that. But most of the people, they prefer the oral drugs, and that is artemisinin compound. But artemisinin is, you know, now the last medicine that we have in malaria. Few years back, as we used to say, we have to protect rifampicin for the treatment of tuberculosis. Because if the patient develops rifampicin-resistant tuberculosis, that time we didn't have any drug to treat a MDR-TB. Similarly, if the patient becomes artemisinin-resistant malaria, we don't have newer drugs. And therefore, please remember that artemisinin combination therapy has to be given. So that is called as an ACT therapy. And the commonest that you use is artemether lumefantrine. And there are other combinations also, artesunate amodiaquine, artesunate mefloquine, artesunate sulfadioxine, pyrimethamine, and all that. But most popular and easy to handle and easy to administer is artemether lumefantrine. Then our friend, enteric fever, S typhi, S paratyphi, A and B. Now these patients come with high fever, which does not touch baseline. Even if you give antipyretics like paracetamol or any other thing, many people give NICE also, but that is not correct. The fever does not touch the baseline. It goes on increasing every day, and therefore it was called as a step ladder pattern. So every day it is increasing. But this step ladder pattern nowadays we don't see so often because, again, because of our subclinical immunity, that is one. Secondly, before coming to us, the patient has gone to some doctors and they have taken either antibiotics or antipyretics. So classical step ladder pattern is not seen. But what is important is high fever, and in spite of the treatment, it doesn't touch the baseline. The patient looks very toxic. He has a coated tongue. He has a relative bradycardia. Usually when the body temperature increases, the pulse rate increases. But here, the pulse rate does not increase pari passu with the temperature. So this is called as a relative bradycardia. Toxic look and coated tongue. He has a splenomegaly. And therefore, we should make a diagnosis of enteric fever. Now, previously, many, many years back, 30, 40 years back, when I was a student, we were told about the Vidal test. Now, Vidal is a testing antibody, and that time we used to do it in dilution, and therefore we used to get a titer. So S typhi O, 1 in 40 was not diagnostic. It was 1 in 80 was diagnostic. But this Vidal comes positive on the 7th day, and we can't wait for a diagnosis till 7th day. Okay, so Vidal test has become obsolete. Please don't waste the money of your patient. Instead of that, we can do typhi IgM, which is the immediate response IgM antibodies, or we can do the blood culture in the first 24 hours. Next day, we will get the report of S typhi. The treatment is also, of course, with macrolides and cephalosporins. And lastly, I think this is last one, acute urinary tract infection. This can happen around the year anytime. More common in the woman, as you know, the cause, that female urethra is a straight urethra. It is not an S-shaped urethra like males. Secondly, it is getting often traumatized during the sexual act. So this is more, and the genital hygiene, which is very, very poor in our, some of our women. So this is more common in the females. Then we have to ask about the predisposing factors like history of diabetes. In diabetes, urinary tract infection is very common because there is a lot of sugar going in the urine. The bacteria can thrive very well. Obstructive uropathy. Patient has some renal stone, urethral stone, bladder stone. So there is an obstruction. The urine remains collected and easy for bacteria to invade. So obstructive uropathy. The patient comes with acute onset high fever with chills. These are chills, not rigors, but there are chills. There is a dysuria. The patient complains of pain while passing urine. There is a burning micturition and there is increased frequency. The frequency is increased, but the every time patient goes to pass urine, she passes hardly few drops of the urine. And that is very, very diagnostic that she is having acute urinary tract infection. The simplest examination is a urine examination, and that shows the presence of pus cells. If the patient is recurrently getting urinary tract infection, then it is better that we do her urine culture sensitivity and we also do the USG abdomen to find out if there is any obstructive uropathy. Well, how we have to treat it with urinary antibiotics, you know them very well. And you don't forget urinary antiseptics, they also have a role. And if the patient is repeatedly getting this urinary tract infections, particularly diabetics, we can give long-term antiseptics like furadentin, nitrofurantoin. So fever can't be diagnosed on day one. Nobody can diagnose fever on day one, okay? So we have to study this fever. Ask the patient to keep a temperature chart. Many a times I tell the patient that if you are getting low grade fever, I'll make a diagnosis of TB. If you are getting high grade fever, the diagnosis will be different. So please buy a thermometer and measure the temperature and keep a chart. Dr. Asrani said very classically, as one could do it in JJ Hospital every 2 hourly. If not every 2 hourly, at least do it 4 hourly. And when you feel that I am feeling feverish, at that time, please mark that time and write the temperature. So temperature record. Ask for fever, presence of fever in other family members. So we know that there is a common infection in the family. Then for the children, we know about the exanthematous fevers, which are different. And elderly, immune-compromised people like diabetics or because of the age, they can get bacterial infection, and also don't forget fungal infections. They also will give a fever and they're common in the immune-compromised people. So investigations, if I have to do, as somebody wants to diagnose the fever on day one, which is not possible, but if you really want to investigate a patient on day one, these are the investigations you will advise. Complete hemogram, emphasis on WBC, packed cell and platelet count. Smear for malarial parasite, falciparum, vivax antigens. Dengue NS1 antigen, IgM dengue, IgG dengue. IgM leptospirosis, BACTEC for culture. HTPT and serum creatinine. And serum electrolyte. Electrolytes, because in every fever, he is losing water from the body and therefore there will be electrolyte abnormality. So all these investigations, even then, they will take 24 hours for the report to come. So we cannot diagnose any fever on day one. And now we come to the COVID-19. But before that, Dr. Asrani will be talking about some lab things. But I'll just give you an introduction that COVID-19 is acute viral infection. It is known to us since last 8 to 9 months. Daily, some new information is coming. It is highly transmissible. Therefore, we are locked down and we are, you know, imprisoned in our houses. Autopsies have not been done. And therefore, you all have read that novel, Final Diagnosis, which comes from the autopsies, from the pathology, which was not possible. There is no definitive treatment as on today. And therefore, there is a lot of panic. There is lack of infrastructure. If you remember, when there was HIV also, there was panic reaction first. But this panic is different. I mean, that time with HIV, people didn't know how it is transmitted, and therefore there was a panic. But today, here it is transmitted by aerosols, and therefore there is more panic. So when we are talking about this COVID-19, what is most important is safety in the healthcare setting and for the healthcare workers. And Dr. Asrani has already explained to you about these things. Now, before Dr. Asrani, I think I'll request him to elaborate a few things about some laboratory parameters that we are commonly hearing in this COVID area, something like CRP, D-dimer, ferritin. So, Dr. Asrani, please.
Thank you, ma'am, for amazing insight into the fevers in such a short time. Now, as we said, that fever can't be diagnosed on day one. Understand one thing, we cannot tell patient to come back on day three, because we have all seen patient even with dengue and malaria going into ARDS or AKI on day two or three, an acute UTI going into gram-negative septicemia, which could be fatal. Since most of us treat a lot of pediatric patients, I would like to share something which I heard almost 26 years back from Dr. Amdekar, one of the seasoned pediatric teachers. When you are looking at a child with fever and you do not have a diagnosis, before you send the child out, ask yourself, can this child die in next 24 hours? I even use it for adults before telling them, ki, you go home, don't worry, I am here. Smaller thing in children, which can kill, because children, number one, have very low immunity. And few things which we practitioners do not remember is our basic anatomy. An acute otitis media, bacterial sinusitis, or a bacterial tonsillitis, all these three parts of our body are barely 2 to 3 inches away from the brain. And hematogenous infection spread can lead to meningitis. So please, you may not ask yourself this question, can this patient die in 24 hours? But ask yourself, am I missing something? Just because we give a patient a diagnosis, hey, ghabruna ka viral hai, doesn't mean it's viral. We are missing something. And as ma'am has said, all viral infections have a potential to create a cytokine storm. And the worst thing for a doctor is a relative coming next day after the patient's death and asking, sir, did you not understand that this could be fatal? So few things which are now become common household words. In my clinic, for last 5 to 6 years, we have been using pulse oximeter for every patient who comes in. Vitals are charted whether they have fever or not. So a little bit on pulse oximeter. Is a non-invasive method used to monitor heart rate and oxygen saturation in the blood. Before this device came on, the only way of monitoring oxygen saturation was through arterial blood gases. Though the reading of SpO2 is not always identical to the more desirable reading of SaO2 from the arterial blood, the two are correlated well enough that pulse oximeter, a safe, convenient, non-invasive, inexpensive pulse oximetry method, is valuable for measuring oxygen saturation, and it can be done repeatedly. The device uses wavelengths of light to measure absorbance in pulsing blood, venous blood, and skin. You get false low readings if a patient is wearing nail polish, very dark nail polish, there is poor light in the clinic, or patient keeps moving the finger. Regular monitoring and recording is required before we go to this, pulse oximeter, anything respiratory. Now, before the COVID era came in, we used to use pulse oximeter to decide in acute attacks of asthma and COPD whether the patient needs hospitalization for oxygen or not. The cutoff there is any SpO2 below 92. The patient better be in a nursing home or a hospital. If one session of nebulizer does not help, in many pulse oximeters, in addition to the SpO2 and the pulse rate, they also give something known as a PI, which is the perfusion index. Perfusion index is the ratio of pulsatile blood flow to the non-pulsatile static blood flow in patient's fingertips. So, in the arteries, capillaries, and the venous capillaries, PI is an indication of pulse strength at the sensor site. The PI values range from 0.02 for very weak pulse to 20% for extremely strong pulse. It's a good indicator of reliability of pulse oximeter reading. If PI is below 0.4, oximeter is not to be relied upon. In a neonatal acute care setting, a low PI has been shown to be an objective and accurate measure of acute illness. C-reactive protein, COVID, as ma'am told you, that all the clinical terms, all the complications we have been seeing before, all the investigations we have been doing before, but now in COVID era, they have some more significant importance. As we all know, C-reactive protein is produced by the liver. It is a non-specific marker for inflammation. It is like when you are walking on the road and you see in a house outside a building a police van and 10-12 police officers, then you know some crime has occurred. You do not know what crime has occurred. So similarly, C-reactive protein will tell you, well, there is inflammation. It will tell you how severe the inflammation is. But where, like when we tell patient, blood test se infection samajhta hai because of leukocytosis, they immediately ask, kahan pe hai infection? Similarly, this is a non-specific marker. CRP levels rise when there is inflammation throughout the body. It reveals inflammation somewhere in the body but cannot pinpoint the exact location. High sensitive CRP has been mooted as an indicative of coronary artery disease, but there are other parameters, so we are not going to diagnose a patient of coronary artery disease basis HSCRP and start on medication. It levels rise dramatically during inflammation and increases due to a rise in the plasma concentration of interleukin produced predominantly by macrophages and adipocytes. In this last 5 months, the highest CRP I have seen is a 5-year-old child who had fever of 103 and 4. CRP was 362. But it was non-COVID. It was because of a severe follicular tonsillitis. During the acute phase response, CRP levels increase rapidly within 2 hours of acute insult, rise above normal within 6 hours, and peak at 48 hours. One thing we must keep in mind, with resolution of the acute phase response, CRP declines with a half-life of 18 hours. So if the inflammation is controlled, within 18 hours, CRP should return to near normal. How this thing is important? CRP can rise up to 50,000 fold in acute inflammation, such as during a severe infection. Its level is mainly determined by its rate of production because of its constant half-life. So understand one thing, if you are checking the CRP on 10th day of the fever and it is high, do not think it is high because the infection is 10 day old. The CRP earlier CRP has gone in 18 hours, this CRP is new production. That means there is active inflammation. So any CRP that you see is showing that it is active inflammation. You cannot say that 360 CRP will take 1 month to go down. No, the child became normal within 5 days, the CRP touched 6. One exception is that CRP elevation in the absence of clinically significant inflammation indicates renal failure. Ferritin, another test that we do in patients of anemia, in anemia profile, is a protein that contains iron. A ferritin test helps evaluate iron body stores. So in our primary practice, we do ferritin when we are treating a resistant anemia, or when I am treating a patient of a resistant or recurrent hair fall. Ferritin has a big range, but one needs at least 65 milligram of ferritin to ensure that hair fall doesn't occur. If ferritin level is lower than normal, it indicates low iron stores and iron deficiency. If ferritin is higher than normal, it could indicate a condition that causes body to store too much iron. One of it may be hemochromatosis. It would also point to liver disease, rheumatoid arthritis, other inflammatory conditions, or maybe hyperthyroidism. Some types of cancer also cause ferritin levels to be high. Ferritin in COVID-19. An analysis of peripheral blood of 69 patients with severe COVID. Now understand, it is severe COVID, it's not very severe COVID. Revealed elevated levels of ferritin compared with patients with non-severe disease. Therefore, it was concluded that serum ferritin levels were closely related to severity of COVID-19. This is a study of June 1, 2020. Another study with 20 COVID-19 patients, it was found that individuals with severe and very severe COVID-19 exhibited increased serum ferritin level. Serum ferritin in very severe COVID was as high as 1006. Nanograms per ml, and in severe group was 291. So you can understand the level of ferritin correlates with the severity of the COVID-19 infection. In agreement with this, another study revealed that in patients who died by COVID-19, ferritin levels were very high upon hospital admission and throughout the hospital stay. Lastly, D-dimer. D-dimer till now we have been doing for diagnosis of deep vein thrombosis or pulmonary embolism. It's a fibrin degradation product, a small protein fragment present in the blood after a blood clot is degraded by fibrinolysis. It's after the clot is degraded by fibrinolysis that D-dimer is produced. D-dimer concentration is determined to help diagnose thrombosis. It's an important test performed in patients suspected of thrombotic disorders. While a negative result of D-dimer practically rules out thrombosis, a positive result can indicate thrombosis but does not rule out other potential causes. Its main use is to exclude thromboembolic disease, deep vein thrombosis, pulmonary embolism. D-dimer in COVID, commonly elevated in patients with COVID-19, it has been reported that abnormal D-dimer levels are associated with poor prognosis. Not only indicate severe disease, but also gives a poor prognosis. D-dimer levels correlate with disease severity and are a reliable prognostic marker for in-hospital mortality in patients admitted for COVID-19. D-dimer levels of 2.14, more than 2.14 milligram per liter, predicted in-hospital mortality with a sensitivity of 88.2 and specificity of 71.3 when DVT and pulmonary embolism have been excluded. So there was a question by Dr. Jumani. When do we check procalcitonin? Or rather, procalcitonin should be checked in second or third day. Procalcitonin is actually a marker of sepsis. So if in a patient you are suspecting bacterial sepsis, that too severe, grade 3 or 4 sepsis, then you can do that. But it is not for other viral or just bacterial infections which have not gone to sepsis stage. CRP nowadays for fevers that we are doing, the commonest test we do is hemoglobin, CBC and CRP. That at least tells us which way the things are going. And the way CRP is rising, I have seen that if there's another infection in the body, then up to 20-30 CRP can be taken as a non-COVID. And third test that we do is a urinary tract infection. So CBC, CRP and urine routine analysis is a good thing for us to do in first, second day of fever if we have monitored fever. There's a question, how to handle cases of allergy rashes after azithromycin? If you identified the cause of the rash, then the first thing is to stop the offending drug. And then hematocrit high interpretation is that it is hemoconcentration. It indicates hemoconcentration because of capillary leak. The patient is in dehydration. This patient needs to be in the hospital.
Okay, we go with this COVID. Now this COVID-19, 1 minute. This is caused by coronavirus. Now, first coronavirus was identified in 1960. Up till now, 6 groups have been identified. This is beta coronavirus. Coronavirus is also known as SARS-CoV-2. Okay, so we say corona, but there are 6 groups. And this present virus, which is causing COVID, is SARS Severe Acute Respiratory Syndrome Coronavirus 2. They all cause respiratory illness. So remember, they are all respiratory viruses. Till now, widely accepted portal of entry is upper respiratory tract. Virus remains in the upper respiratory tract for 48 to 72 hours. Now remember this timing. It remains in the upper respiratory tract for 48 to 72 hours. And therefore, it is during this time, if we take nasopharyngeal swab, and it has to be taken very carefully, it must touch the posterior pharyngeal wall, nasopharynx, and then it has to be properly stored and transported. And then only the test will come positive. Because nowadays you see that this test came negative and still he had corona and all. This is because of the technique which is faulty. So the virus remains there for 48 to 72 hours. Then the innate immunity may clear it. It is not that we are not immune. Our body has an immune response to this virus and it may clear it. So it was a mild infection which was cleared by the body. If not, it goes to the lower respiratory tract and reaches the pneumocyte. On the pneumocytes, there is Now, how it is transmitted? It is transmitted through the aerosol. And as you can see here, the aerosol, this is a droplet infection. And therefore, we always talk about the distance between the two has to be more than 6 feet. If it is less than 6 feet, the aerosol, the micro droplets can transmit the infection. Therefore, the use of mask and the social distancing has come into the play. Okay. Now about this virus, when it goes to the lungs, it uses ACE2 receptors for its entry into the pneumocyte. The virus replicates by RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. As I said, this is RNA viruses. The viral RNA and viral proteins assemble together to form a new virion in the Golgi apparatus of the pneumocyte. The virions are released from the cells. Large number of extrapulmonary tissue also express ACE2 receptors, and that is how the virus gets disseminated to various organ systems. That is what we must remember. Now, because it was a respiratory virus, all the time we were concentrating on the lungs and we were talking about the pneumonia. There is an innate immune response. There is a suppression of interferon. Viral replication triggers hyperinflammatory condition, which results into release of cytokine, which we have been talking right from all these viral infections like dengue, like chikungunya, like H1N1. So there is a triggering of hyperinflammatory condition because of the release of cytokines. This is called as a cytokine storm, which is related to the severity of the disease. If there is a cytokine storm, this will, because if it is a mild infection, it will get controlled by the innate immunity. But if it is a severe infection, there will be a cytokine storm, and therefore it indicates the severity of the disease. There is influx of activated neutrophils, monocytes, macrophages. CD4, CD8 cells are suppressed, but they are in a hyperactivated state. Now what has happened? Up till now, we were thinking that it is pneumonia. The patients had pneumonia, pneumonia, and pneumonia. Then they said that there is a pulmonary fibrosis. And therefore, the patients were put on ventilator and they were treated, and the mortality was quite high. The autopsies were not done. There are lakhs and lakhs of people who have died in Wuhan, and there are all over the world, but the autopsies were not done because WHO had prohibited them, looking at the infectious nature of this disease. But in Italy, two pathologists, they were really courageous enough, and they conducted the autopsies. 38 autopsies were done, and they have examined the histopathology, immunohistochemistry, and under the electron microscope. And what they found, that there was a diffuse alveolar disease. There was loss of pneumocytes. There was hyaline membrane formation, interstitial edema. What was more important, which was not like pneumonia, that was platelet fibrin thrombi in small arteries of less than 1 millimeter in diameter. Large number of CD68 macrophages were there. There were increased number of megakaryocytes, and viral particles were seen in the alveoli. Fibrin thrombi were seen. So this patient whom we were taking it as pneumonia were actually the cases of microembolism into the pulmonary vasculature. And that changed the treatment of this disease. Now, all these people also had high levels of D-dimer, and they had a severe hypoxemia. There is also a term called as silent hypoxia. What is this silent hypoxia? Pathophysiological basis of respiratory failure still undetermined. Every day there is new information. And because there are no autopsies, we really do not know what is happening. But whatever the data is now coming out, that there is a DIC like a picture, and that is seen in the lung. The lung capillaries are embolized, they are thrombosed. Now, there is alveolar damage, there is interstitial thickening leading to compromised gas exchange. Now, with autopsy revelations, clinical observations that patients with SpO2 less than 40, they were alert, calm on social media. Now, just imagine SpO2 40 and they were still calm. They were absolutely conscious. They were happily working on their social media. It was really a surprise. And therefore, the autopsies threw light on this. What happens? This carbon dioxide diffuses from the tissues 20 times faster than the oxygen. And therefore, there was a disproportionate pulmonary gas exchange. And this was a hypocapnic hypoxemia. Now remember, if the oxygen levels go down and the carbon dioxide levels increase, this carbon dioxide is actually the trigger or a stimulus to the respiratory center to make the patient tachypneic, you know, because of the air hunger. But here, this was hypocapnic hypoxemia because the capillaries were blocked, there was a disproportionate pulmonary gas exchange, and therefore these patients, although the SpO2 was so low, they were happy, they were conscious, they were working on their social media, and suddenly they used to drop dead. You must have seen those pictures in Wuhan, that the people standing on the road and they just drop dead. And this was the, these were the cases of silent hypoxia. So that means, apart from that pneumonia which required the ventilatory support, now it is that these pulmonary vasculature which is thrombosed, and therefore there is gas exchange which is affected, and that is what is becoming the pathophysiology of COVID. So of course there is a respiratory failure, no doubt. There is pneumonia, there is ARDS leading to acute respiratory failure. This virus is cytopathic. Cytopathic means it damages, it attacks the cells and damages them. So cytopathic virus, it triggers the hyperimmune response. As a hyperimmune response, there are cytokines which are released, and therefore there is a cytokine release syndrome, like cytokine storm, which we have seen in dengue and other viral infection. There is a secondary hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis. And there are microthrombi, that means there is a coagulopathy, a picture exactly similar to disseminated intravascular coagulation. And therefore, we measure D-dimer in these patients. So how it is diagnosed? We have to take a nasopharyngeal swab. It has to be properly collected. And it is sent for SARS-CoV-2 antigen test. The SARS-CoV-2 antigen test takes about 2 hours. That means the result will be available immediately. Now there is a lot of things and a lot of gossip going around because of this test. The people are saying, you know, the sensitivity of the test is slightly low, but it is quite specific. Secondly, it has to be properly collected. Now on the WhatsApp or social media, I'm nowadays reading a lot of gossip about the laboratory and laboratory nexus with the doctors and the hotels and the hospital. I don't know. I mean, I will not comment on that. But this antigen test is quite reliable, and that antigen test gives you a rapid diagnosis. And this should be done in patients who come to you with any symptoms of COVID disease. The next test is SARS-CoV-2 RT-PCR. Actually, this RT-PCR, again from the nasopharyngeal swab, it takes 6 to 8 hours. But because of the workload or whatever reason, the laboratories take minimum 48 hours to give the report. And therefore, this is the test. And then COVID antibody test. Now, is antibody test, will it help us in diagnosing COVID? No. Because the antibodies will develop only when the patient is responding to the viral infection. So antibody test, like all other antibody tests, will tell you that the patient had corona infection in past. So antibody test will not tell you about the acute infection. For acute infection, we have to do an antigen test and we have to do the RT-PCR. Now one word, I'll deviate from the main topic. When the patient comes and you suspect that there is a corona infection, if you ask him to get the test done, usually the patient doesn't go and get the test done. Because again, because of the social media, the patient knows that once he is positive, he will be quarantined. He will be isolated. Now, wherever there is a quarantine facility, the facilities, you know, even the hygienic facilities are not available there. He doesn't get proper food. And therefore, he is absolutely reluctant to get a test done and go to these places. That is one reason. Secondly, this is a word going around on the social media. Arey, positive nikla, waha gaye, toh bhi kya dete? Kuch bhi nahi dete. There is no dawa. So they only give you some vitamins, which you give me and I'll take it at home. And therefore, they are reluctant to get the test done. Now, you being a doctor, you have to treat the patient, so you give him some medicine. And therefore, he doesn't do the test, he goes away. Because he had a mild disease, now naturally, he doesn't suffer for more than 3 or 4 days. But this is the person who is going to transmit the infection to the rest of the community. Because he remains, he remains the spreader for next 10 days. because he is positive, and therefore it is better that we counsel this patient, we counsel the family members, get the test done, because without the test you cannot differentiate between, you know, with the patient having mild symptom, you cannot differentiate him from other viral illnesses like acute URI or whether it is you know, any other acute respiratory syndrome. So therefore we have to do the test and tell the patient, because this is to stop the community spread. He can have a home isolation. It is not necessary that he has to be quarantined in the quarantine center. And therefore antigen test is quite useful and should be done in all the suspected cases. Now, what are the clinical parameters? As I said, this is a viral infection. We'll have the same thing like all your other viral infections that we discussed so far. The patient can remain asymptomatic, that his immunity is so good that he is fighting with the virus, he is absolutely asymptomatic. And today, every day you are reading now that there are large number of people who are asymptomatic. The only problem with the asymptomatic person is that he doesn't accept that he is COVID unless we do the test. And therefore, he is the person who is transmitting this infection in the society. He is pre-symptomatic person. 1 to 3 days prior to the symptoms onset, we call him as pre-symptomatic. Then there is a symptomatic person and post-symptomatic person. The symptomatic person, now he has been treated, he has fought the battle with the COVID virus, and now he's a post-symptomatic person. So there can be a mild infection, usually does not need any inpatient care. There can be moderate infection, which requires admission for care and typically presents with pneumonia. And there is a severe infection, which requires intensive care and typically includes respiratory failure. Now, if we see around and see the statistics, about 85 to 90% of the patients are having mild infection. Another 5 to 8% of the patients are having moderate infection, and only 1 to 3% of the patients are having severe infection. So the panic reaction, of course, it is there, and we have to accept the panic. I'm not saying no, but at the same time, we have to counsel the patient and give him the moral support to fight this particular new virus. Okay, there is a severity spectrum which is given by NIH guidelines. So there is asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic infection. He tests positive for SARS-CoV-2, but he has no symptoms. Therefore, we call it as pre-symptomatic or symptomatic. That means his test is positive. Therefore, we know that he is infected, but he just doesn't have any symptoms. Therefore, we call him as asymptomatic or pre-symptomatic. If there is a mild illness, then what are the symptoms? And you name any symptom and that is described for this particular infection. First of all, it is a viral infection. So all the viral prodrome will be there. The varied symptoms, there is a mild fever. There is mild fever which goes on increasing. Cough, sore throat, malaise, headache, muscle pain, anosmia. He has loss of smell sensation. That I told you, even with severe cold and blocked nose, the patient doesn't smell, and therefore he starts worrying whether I have got this. And the best way to differentiate is only to get the test. Without that, we cannot make a diagnosis. So there is anosmia. Now, recently you have also the patients with loss of taste, particularly the sour taste. Then there is diarrhea, because this virus is excreted in the stools and the patient comes with GI symptoms, particularly diarrhea. There is unexplained weakness, fatigability. All these are the symptoms which point to the exposure to the coronavirus. And unless we do the test, we cannot say whether the person is infected or not. But with all these symptoms, there is no shortness of breath. There is no dyspnea. And therefore, we call it as mild illness. At the same time, along with the COVID antigen test, we should also do the X-ray chest. But more important than the X-ray chest is a HRCT. Because now, you know, there are a lot of studies coming from North India that HRCT really helps you. Even before your clinical picture, it helps you to make a diagnosis of corona infection, and that is called, as you know, Corad 1, Corad 2, Corad 3, Corad 4 and 5 are even in absence of or a negative test is diagnostic of COVID disease. Moderate illness. Now, all throughout this, we have to do the oximetry and see what is the SpO2 level. In moderate illness, the SpO2 is more than 94%, and lower respiratory disease evidenced by clinical assessment or imaging. Imaging is HRCT. Severe illness, SpO2 is less than 94. PaO2 by fractional O2 is less than 300. Respiratory rate is 30 breaths. That means there is a shortness of breath. And lung infiltrates, which are seen more than 50%. So either on the X-ray chest or on HRCT, that is a severe illness. What is critical illness? There is a respiratory failure. There is a septic shock and multi-organ dysfunction. Once the patient develops a bacterial infection, it immediately lands into septic shock. And with the septic shock, naturally the sequelae is multi-organ dysfunction. In the mild cases, what is the treatment? The treatment is vitamin C, 500 milligram BID. Zinc should be given as lozenges, 50 to 75 milligrams per day for 30 days. And after a month, you can reduce the dose to 30 to 50 milligrams per day. Vitamin D3, 2000 to 4000 units per day. Although it is a mild infection, the patient should be isolated. Otherwise, he will transmit the infection to the other people. We have been talking about hydroxychloroquine, 400 milligram BD on the first day, and then OD for 4 days. But hydroxychloroquine, dear doctors, I must tell you, is a very, very controversial subject. Hydroxychloroquine, there are studies which show a very good response in the mild cases. It's used as a prophylaxis. It's good for prophylaxis. But at the same time, there are studies from America and many of the European countries which have said that treatment HCQ actually has been shown in the laboratory to inhibit the viral replication. But HCQ given in the COVID patient, probably COVID heart, which is prone to develop, you know, the arrhythmias, and people who were on HCQ developed toxidipoint and they died of cardiac arrest. And therefore, the Western world is against giving the hydroxychloroquine. Even recently, I think 3-4 days back, I read it in Times of India, that all our healthcare workers were given hydroxychloroquine as prophylaxis, out of which 102 people developed corona infection. However, they have not mentioned that the corona infection that they developed was mild infection, not moderate or severe. So there is definitely some role of HCQ in prophylaxis and also in the treatment of mild cases. But as on today, it is controversial. I leave it to your discretion. The other thing is capsule doxy, 200 milligrams BD for 1 day and then OD for next 4 days. Tablet favipiravir, 1800 milligram twice a day on day one, and then 800 milligram twice a day for 6 days. Now, this is an antiviral agent. Now, it is supposed to be antiviral, but you know, there are no randomized controlled trials because there is no time and there is no, you know, it's today we are in a hurry to manage our patient, and therefore to conduct a randomized controlled trials, people really don't have the time to carry out the research. In fact, favipiravir, remdesivir, tocilizumab, all these drugs have their own companies have declared have failed in stage 3 trial. Okay, but still we are using them in patients and some of them are really showing good response. So for mild infection, favipiravir, 1800 milligram BD day 1 and then 800 milligram BD for 6 days. Another thing which has come is ivermectin. This is a drug developed from Japan. 12 milligrams OD for 3 days. Plus famotidine. It has also been shown to inhibit the virus. And therefore, in mild infection, you can give doxy, favipiravir, ivermectin, and famotidine combination. This is a combination, not single drug. Okay? And monitor with oximetry. So although we are giving these drugs, these are again, you know, because of lack of randomized controlled trial, I can't be 100% sure that this will be effective. Therefore, this is the drug under, you know, sort of we are giving on humanitarian basis, and therefore it is prudent to monitor with oximetry. As the SpO2 will be dropping, nasal oxygen if required, and for nasal oxygen, you should advise the patient hospitalization. Moderate infection, as because of these microthrombi seen in pulmonary vasculature, now they have added enoxaparin 60 milligram daily. The dose is 1 milligram per kg, 12 hourly if the D-dimer is high. So therefore, we do D-dimer in moderate cases. If it is increasing or if it is high, enoxaparin or low molecular weight heparin should be given twice a day. Methylprednisolone, because there is a cytokine storm, which is again because of the inflammatory condition, and that is treated with methylprednisolone 40 milligram 12 hourly, increased to 80 milligram 12 hourly if CRP is increasing. CRP again, as Dr. Asrani told you, is a biomarker of inflammation, and therefore methylprednisolone is used. Famotidine, again 40 milligram daily, 20 milligram is given if the patient has renal impairment. The optional treatment is ivermectin in moderate cases, 150 to 200 microgram per kg, and that dose can be repeated on day 2. Nasal oxygen to be continued. And then there are severe cases which will not come in the purview of family physician. These severe cases have to be hospitalized, have to be managed in the ICU. They are given non-invasive ventilation. They are given ventilation in the prone position. They are given antiviral drugs like remdesivir. And lastly, the plasma therapy. This is only for the sake of information that I'm telling you. But as on today, the only thing that we have to practice is we have to use the mask and social distancing and isolate the patient who is detected to be positive. Thank you very much.
Ma'am, there are some questions.
Okay.
Shrita, please ask.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, ma'am, for that talk. So there are a few questions that we've collected from the chat box. The first question that we had was, what was the treatment of leptospirosis?
Of?
Leptospirosis.
Okay, leptospirosis. When I was a resident, we used to give penicillin. But now penicillin is not available only. Therefore, we give amoxicillin. Ampicillin or amoxicillin.
Second question was dose of primaquine in G6PD.
G6PD, if it is positive, I will not give primaquine. I have not come across any modified dose, but it will precipitate the hemolysis. So, no.
Next question we had was what was the cause of hypoglycemia in malaria?
Okay, the exact cause is not known. Hypoglycemia occurs more commonly after quinine injection, but we have seen patient coming with periodicity, that means hypoglycemia occurring at a particular time, maybe because the parasites are using up the glucose. I don't know. The exact mechanism is not known.
Okay. Could you please repeat happy hypoxia, the concept of happy hypoxia in COVID?
Okay. See, whenever the patient develops hypoxia, that means oxygen level is low. Low oxygen is not a trigger for the respiratory center. Because the moment the oxygen is going down, we expect that the respiratory center should be active, should stimulate the respiration, the respiratory rate should increase, there should be a problem with the brain, the conscious level and all. But that doesn't happen. The trigger is actually when there is an exchange which is taking place. The oxygen becomes low and carbon dioxide becomes high. And this high carbon dioxide is actually the trigger for the respiratory center. Now in COVID, what is happening? Because of this microthrombi in the capillaries are blocked. And therefore, in the alveoli, oxygen has come. And alveoli can also send out the carbon dioxide, which, diffuses out at such a high speed. So there is a hypocapnia, not hypercapnia. And because there is no hypercapnia, the respiratory center is not stimulated. So there is a hypoxia. And in spite of hypoxia, the patient is happy. Patient is active on the social media. And then he suddenly drops dead because of the lack of oxygen. So this is initially was not understood, but after the autopsies in the Italian patient, we realized that these are microthrombi in pulmonary vasculatures, which is causing this disproportionate gas exchange. And carbon dioxide is diffusing out, but this oxygen is not diffusing in. Okay.
And one more last question. Should doctors do the antibody test for COVID?
If they are managing the patient, they should. I mean, if you are antibody positive, that means you have recovered from the corona infection. So you should be safe. You can even donate your blood for plasma therapy. I agree. I was just saying it lightly, but the doctors, because unless you are following the principles which Dr. Asrani said, in a small room, if you are getting exposed, the density of the virions in that room will be high. And therefore, it is possible that if you are good immunity, therefore you fought with that virus, you did not develop any symptoms, and today your corona antibody is positive. That means you had the infection. So nothing is to be done about it now. But at least you can be safe that you will not get it over the next few months. We do not know how long the antibodies last, because the disease is so new that we are all growing with this disease. We are getting more information.
Ma'am, a doctor wants to know whether vitamins work or it is just a placebo.
It's not a placebo. I suppose vitamin C is an antioxidant. Zinc also has been shown to have a role with these ACE2 inhibitors, where it blocks the entry of the virus inside the cell. Vitamin C, actually, in the critical cases, the dose advised is vitamin C 3 grams intravenously. And that is being given in the critical cases. So vitamin C definitely has a role. Zinc has a role. And therefore, it has been advocated. It is not a placebo.
Ma'am, antibody test if we do and it is negative, should they repeat every 2 months or 3 months?
I don't think so. I mean, doing that test, what are we going to gain?
Nothing, just that you can be a little bolder in treating people, that's all.
I know. No, even, there is a lot of discussion about the BCG also. Because our people are BCG vaccinated, therefore the disease, spread is limited and all that. Some doctors have even taken the BCG vaccine. Now, these things are coming in, but they are not been proved as on today. And why BCG vaccine? Because all of us have subclinically been exposing to tuberculosis. So maybe we are, we already have that delayed type of a hypersensitivity or immune reaction.
Madam, there are two questions. Is it possible to have T-cell mediated immunity and antibody titer is still negative? And secondly, window period of antibody test.
Window period of antibody.
Like within how many days it should come possible?
See, the person remains infectious for first 10 days. So after 10 days, in those 10 days, he is developing antibodies. So they should come positive after 10 days. But if there is a suspected patient or who was corona positive, we usually do the antibody test at the end of 4 weeks. And if the antibody titer is high, his plasma is taken for plasma therapy.
Okay, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, audience.
I hope the audience enjoyed the session. Look forward to meeting them again on some other issues.
Yeah, and there are a lot of questions which we will try and answer on the WhatsApp groups.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you.